nuclear plant. Brothers, we have to remember that this where we are right now is a holy place. And just like the brother said in the beginning, we have to respect it accordingly. You have to remember, especially everybody here, not just the musicians, not just me who's talking, not just the pastors, but you have to remember that we all have a very, we have a duty to God to represent ourselves in His manner to everybody who sees us, right? It says, let the light shine, right? Let God be shown through you, right? When other people see you, who do they see? When you see me, who do you see? Not just in church, with a tie, dressed up pants, shoes, it means nothing.
Right.
Unless I'm like this, and I act the way, and I do what I need to do, and the light that is inside of me shows to those around me, right?
Right.
Because you can have a brother that's dressed up in the most fancy, expensive pants and tie, but then when he's outside of church, his tongue and what he says doesn't match what you see. Who respects God here? I mean, who really respects God? Do you respect him like your parents or like your friend? Because there's a difference. He's both. He's your friend when you need a friend, and he is your parent when you need a parent. A friend is someone you go to when you need, right? Someone you need them right there. They console you. But a parent gives you advice. And he says, I've been there. I know what you need to do. A friend can't always give you that. We have to remember that this is a holy place, especially, you know, even if you're just sitting there. You have to know that. You have to always remember that you never know when God is coming. The Bible says that I will come like a thief in the night. You don't know if a thief is coming. A thief doesn't let you know that he's going to come rob your house. And God will not let you know when he's coming for you.
Praise God. Glory to this.
And I have such a blessing. I feel so happy when I have the chance to, engage in worship. And, back in my church, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Juan Garcia. My dad is the pastor of Rosario Garcia from Fairfield. It's about 4.5 hour drive from here. And at my church, I normally lead the music, and when you're always constantly up in front, you know, and the musicians that played today played very nice, and I really appreciate, getting to enjoy and be in Alabanza and be free, and, you really get to appreciate, when you're always up in front, you really get to appreciate to be on the other side. There's a lot of brothers, I think, we see the musicians, we say, oh, that's nice, I wish I could be up there, oh, that's easy, I could be up there, I sing good, I play good, I look good, but it's the bigger blessing is to be down and receive the blessing.
Amen.
Because musicians, when we're up in front, what we always have to remember is, and what you have to remember about us, is that we are trying our hardest to be the conductors, right, to be a conductor. A conductor, right, is something that conducts something else, right? So like if you have metal and you have electricity on one side, it conducts the electricity to the other side, right? And that's what musicians are, and that's what pastores are, and that's what ministros are. Is when they're up here, they're the conductors, right? They conduct God's presence to you. And so I know that when the musicians are up here playing and they're worshiping, they're doing it from their heart, because there's one thing you have to know, is if you're up here or in your in church, it's because you love God. If you don't love God, then you don't have a reason. Right? The brother, we opened up with a very beautiful scripture that the brothers told me that they wanted me to revolve my preaching about. And I want us to feel open, and I want you to feel like I am your brother in Christ, because I am. I am your brother in Christ.
Say that.
And this is one brother talking to his brothers and sisters, not a preacher talking to his sheep. In Psalm 1:8:36, if you can open it if you want, but we already read it, and I'm going to reread it just to refresh your memory. It says, if the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. We are all the children of God. We are all the God, like I said before, He can be our friend, but He's our parent, He's our father. And I'm going to say one thing, I just want you to think about this, and then we're going to pray. Is that God protects us, saves us, feeds us, clothes us, because we are His children. And as His children, He frees us. Let's all pray. Thank you, Lord, for the beautiful day of life that you've given me, Lord. I know that I'm not worthy of anything that you've given me, Lord, but please use me in your way, Lord. I ask that you continue to bless me and all those around me, Lord, and you descend upon us in your presence, Lord. And fill this place with your Holy Spirit, Lord, so that we may understand what it is you have in store for us this weekend, Lord. I pray that you open our eyes spiritually, our ears, and our heart, Lord, and fill us with your presence. Amen.
Amen.
Let's all just, everybody stand up real quick and just give it a good stretch.
Grown. A lot of brothers were grown before they found God. We're young. What's hard?
time in my life, the only time I went to God was when I was happy in my life. In fact, there was a time in my life where I just felt so constricted with all the things in my life. I had work, I had problems with this, I had problems with my family, I was getting lost in my home. Fighting with my mom all the time, fighting with my dad, I was in a bad mood all the time, my class, I was failing one of my classes. And that's when I wanted to get, close to God. That's when I really wanted to start to pray. And you know what happened? I started praying. And nothing happened. And I got even warmer. And it wasn't all until I finally realized that I put myself in hands. God was telling me, it's your job to get yourself out. And when you finally realize how to get out, that's when I'm going to help you. God can free you from whatever it is you're going through. Whatever it is. And the funny thing is that brothers don't get it. They don't get it. Their moms don't get it. They don't get that, what God can do. If God can destroy a city, Sodom and Gomorrah, God can help you with all. If God can take a man like Moses, who was born and raised in Egypt, an Egyptian, if he can take a man like Moses and turn him into a man of God to do miracles, to save Israel, you're falling with your boyfriend, your girlfriend, you're falling at school, you're falling at this, you're addicted to whatever it is, God can help you. And sometimes it's not the way you want it. You say, God, so-and-so, I feel so constricted, my boyfriend, girlfriend, they're whatever, this and that, help me, God, help me. And then you get into a big fight, and you break up. And you're like, oh my gosh, and God's like, that's what I did for you. I got rid of the problem. You didn't like it, but that's what I wanted for you. And without you even knowing, God freed you from something that was keeping you, believe it or not. And for all of us that don't know this, if your significant other is getting upset that you're going to church too much, or they say, oh, you go to church too much, whenever they bring up church as an issue in your relationship, that should be a red flag. If they're getting jealous that you see them more than you, or they see you see church more than they see you, that's a problem. And God will free you from that. If you ask them. But we ask him for help, and then when it doesn't come the way we want to cry about it. Let's get some scripture. Psalm 34. And I need everybody to go there. I have my phone here, guys. Don't worry. I will not jack off. But I really want you guys to open your eyes spiritually, and your ears, and your heart all spiritually. It's different than just listening. You have to really understand. Because God might be talking to you, and if you don't want to listen, you hear yourself. Because some of you have come tonight, some of you came to this weekend, and you said, this is when I'm going to stop doing this. This is when I'm going to change. This is when God's going to talk to me. This is when I'm going to. You don't catch it. Psalm 34. Now this is a psalm from a man who talks about how God was able to free him from sin and pain. He's telling everybody this. It's a psalm. It's a song. He's singing it out to everybody. And he says, number one, he says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. It's like, guys, God did this in me. Come on, let's praise him with me. He says, I saw the Lord, and he heard me, and he delivered me from all my fears. They looked unto him and were light, and their faces were not ashamed. They're like, wow, this is the guy that used to be afraid of being alone, he used to be afraid of this, and he used to be afraid of that, and he was this and this and that. Look at him now, guys. And number 6 says, this poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encompassed around them that fear him and deliver them. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. Fear the Lord. It's talking to you. Fear the Lord, ye his saints. For there is no want in him that fear him. That means that if you fear God, if you call on him, he says there is no need or want. That means that you're not going to need anything. Because God's going to bring it to you. He's got you. No, we don't have faith in God. We're too, because of technology, because of different things, we're so used to things being on the fly, on demand. God's prayer, praying to God, that's not on demand. That's not high speed. That takes time. You have to realize that. A prayer has to go through many processes. God hears it, but he has to determine whether or not he's going to answer it to you. You don't think you pray, and it just instantly goes up, and God says, yeah, let me, a new card here. There you go, tomorrow. God has to see that you really need this. We don't think about that. When you're in need, you pray. And yes, God hears you. But if you're just praying just to pray, and you're like, God, if you don't do it from the heart, and you don't do it with fear, let me give you an example of what fear is. Okay? Let me give you an example of fear. Using the musicians as an example. Okay? Musicians have to have fear of God to be able to pray. You know why? And for those of you who don't know this, this is just some facts in the Bible, okay? The musicians in the Bible, right? And other different positions in church, biblical positions. You had to have a certain fear of God. And you had to have certain years in church to have certain positions. You didn't know? But you didn't know. The Levites were considered the musicians back in the day, right? And they had to have certain amount of time and dedication, and they had to really, they had to have years and years. And they had to show their dedication and their knowledge. And they had to have fear of God. The apostles, they couldn't have done anything that God told them to do if they didn't fear God himself. How do you fight a demon? Or how do you heal a sickness? And you're more afraid of it than God? And God made everything? Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivered him out of them all. The God of all gods, the Prince of Peace, El Shaddai, wanted to keep doing everything that you wanted to do, and you wanted me to do what you wanted me to do. you gotta learn. I mean, Holland is like, look at your friends in the world. How many have friends in the world? Me, I do. I've seen them drink and pass out. I've seen them smoke. And I've seen them run, too. And it makes sense that they run like that because they smoke. I'll give you a little testimony. I recently got into a really big fight, verbal fight. One of my best friends, I grew up in kindergarten, best friends, kindergarten. We got in a fight. He was drunk. Oddly enough. And I said, you know what, I can't hang out with you if you're going to be drunk. I'm like, you need to let me know if you're, we're going to hang out, if you're going to be drunk, we can't do this. So they said, no. They said, all right, I need to follow. But you know what he started doing? He started questioning my faith. Why do you go to church so much? Why don't you drink? Come on, take a drink. And he even tried to spike my drink. He tried to spike my drink. After I told him, I grew up with him. He knew I went to church. My best friend. He knew I went to church. Respected it. Now, trying to give me a drink. Try to spike my drink. Question my faith. Why do you believe in God? He gave me all this. And he goes to UCLA, so he was this smart. So he tried to get into this big old conversation. I said, you know what? I'm like, I'm not going to do this again. I'm not. That was the end of that. Psalms 118, verse 5. We have to remember, guys. Prayer is a direct call to God. A direct line to God. A direct request to God. Psalms 118, verse 5. I really love Psalms because these are Psalms from, you know, back in biblical days that the apostles and different men of God really sang, and they really, like, sung this to God. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
these
man.
Really, really powerful Psalms. I mean, if you ever read these and you listen to these, you really understand that all these Psalms are, like, saying the exact same thing that you're going through. There's a Psalm that says, God, basically talks about him, he loses everything. And he's like asking God for forgiveness. And he's like, help me. He's like, come on, like, that's exactly what I go through sometimes. There's another one, he says, God, I promise to be strong. I promise to be there and be there for you and never be moved. And then there's a song right after that from King David that says, God, I'm weak, I'm falling. And it's so ironic because it's like Psalm 24. And David, King David says, God, I'm strong, nothing will happen to me. Superman basically says that. And then the song right after, he's like, God, help me, I'm weak. I don't know what's going on. And that's how we are sometimes. The moment we start saying, God, I got this, I don't need to go to church as much. I'm holy, I'm whatever, this and that. It's the moment God's like, all right, I'm not going to hold you anymore. And then we fall. Psalm 118, 5 says, I called upon the Lord in distress. The Lord answered me. Set me in a large place. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do unto me? It says, I cried to God. Do you understand what these... How many of you guys have figured out what these songs are saying and what all of them are saying? What are they always saying? They don't say, I talked and I chatted. They don't say that I kind of prayed for a couple minutes. My knees started to hurt, and so I stopped, and I can't really pray for a long time, because then I started thinking about other things, so that's why I don't pray for a long time. Sorry. They don't say that. They say that. They say that I cried. They say that I cried unto the Lord. That means a cry, it doesn't mean like tears all the time. That's not what a cry means. A cry means that he just gave himself to God. A cry means that he didn't care who was watching. He said, God, I need you. I'm trapped in an addiction, in the pain, in the suffering, in my parents, in the fights, in the anger that I have. I need you. prayer that you say as soon as you pray. Something that you keep, you already have memorized and you say all the time. Right? You get in a group, you say, God, thank you for the day of life. Please watch over me and my mom and my dad. You You haven't memorized!
Oh, yeah!
You haven't memorized!
Amen.
Throw that stuff away! That's garbage!
Amen!
That's not real! You're not really praying for the brothers that you listen to.
Amen! Hallelujah!
A real prayer is one that you really feel. Yeah. carrying all these burdens. And I know how it feels too. I just finished a summer job that I had where I was an assistant manager, and on Wednesday nights we have service in Fairfield, and we have it at 7 o'clock. And my job was almost half an hour away, and I would get done at 6:30. And I drove straight from work to church. I was stressed, I was tired, I had other things I had to do, I had to get ready to change the church. I started straight there. And it's not for me to be like, it's me, but that fool I am, I drove to church a lot. Now, let's just give you an example. And there'd be days where I come, and I'm just stressed out, and I'm just like really annoyed that I have to go to church. Because I'm coming out of work, I want to go home. And I'm really annoyed, I'm like, why? I have to go to church. And I stay that way in church. And I leave that way in church. And you go to sleep terrible, and the next day is even worse. And I realize, God, it's weird. I go to church, you don't take this church away from me. He's like, well, you never gave it to me. You wanted to keep it and cry and moan about it. I was here. I said, here.
Amen.
He said, no, I'm mad.
Gálatas 3:22.
They're just shifting the country, China, not like the extremist country of China is burning down churches. That's an entire country. And we're like, oh, I gotta go to church, or God, whatever. Be grateful, because there's gonna be a time where people, it's gonna say, the Revelation, the Bible says there's gonna be a time where people are gonna be searching the Word of God, and they're not gonna be able to get it. It's gonna be a rarity. It's gonna be a rare thing to find. And we just throw it around like it's nothing. We act like church is nothing. We expect church like it's whatever, like another part of our day. And that's what it continues to be. You continue to be trapped in your life. And you continue to have problems in your life. You don't realize that freedom starts here. In God, in your heart. In Galatians 3, verse 22 says, that the scripture had concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith that Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under the schoolmaster. For some of you, it says sin instead of schoolmaster. It says, basically, in many terms, it says that we're all under sin. We're all under law. You're all trapped. But because of faith, because of God, because of strength. And my last scripture says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty where Christ has made us free. And be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. It says, stand fast in the liberty that Christ basically says, take it. Take the fact that God's made you free from your sins. Man. Take the fact that God's freed you from whatever it is that He's freed you from. How many of you have had problems where you're like, I keep doing this. God frees you, and then you're like, I'm free, I'm happy, I feel the blessing, and you're on fire, and then you fall, and then you stay down, and then He frees you again, and you're like, I'm fire, I'm on fire. And then you fall again. And the scripture says, take it and keep going. And don't be burdened. And don't be bondage from the yoke of your past.
Amen, amen. Gloria a Dios.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Gloria a Dios.
Life in Egypt, the world. He grew up up there. He loved his parents. He had family there. He loved everything about it. And he had to let that go. Imagine if God took you and said, you hold back to your whole life. It's gone. You're doing this now. But you need to be strong. Could you just like imagine? And he was by himself in the desert. He didn't have anybody. Hope. How do you know the story of hope? He's injured. He loses everything. And he still has the faith. The change and the freedom will come when you decide that you want to be stronger. Ask God to make you stronger to fight your addictions. To make you stronger.
Amen. Gracias.